Welcome to Season 2 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement, and a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, Stephanie Desmon talks to Emanuel Goldman, a microbiology professor at Rutgers University, about hygiene theater, the act of showing our commitment to fighting COVID-19 by the deep cleaning of surfaces. But the science, he says, provides little evidence that surfaces are making us sick, and all of this excess sanitation could be giving a false sense of security. Just wash your hands, he says. Let's listen.
Emanuel Goldman, thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you.
So today I have you here. I want to talk to you about COVID and this concept of hygiene theater, which is really sort of about all the showy ways we're seeing people doing deep cleaning in order to make us feel like they are preventing us from getting sick with COVID. So I'm wondering, with all this talk about cleaning surfaces, how big a problem is keeping those surfaces clean?
Well, from my point of view and from the literature survey that I've done, I think it's a very minor issue.
Mm-hmm. So talk to me about how you're seeing this play out.
Well, I published a comment in the medical journal Lancet, which is a top medical journal. And my comment was essentially a mini review of the literature upon which the whole concept of surface transmission of COVID-19 is based. And in that mini review, I essentially pointed out that there is really very skimpy evidence. And in fact, the way the experiments that were done on which these conclusions have been based, those experiments were done with no relation to real life, no relation to reality.
How so?
So the researchers started out with humongous amounts of virus mm-hmm. on the surfaces that they were investigating. And anywhere from 10,000 up to 10 million virus particles on a small surface area. And then they followed over time how much virus is left. The problem with that experiment is that in a real life situation, you're not going to get anywhere near that amount of virus on the surface from an infected person. You might get tops 100 virus particles, mm-hmm. or more in the neighborhood of 10, between 10 and 100 anyway. And if you have that low amount to start with, that amount will be gone much, much sooner than what was published in those papers. And that's because viruses have a half-life. They survive for a certain amount of time, and then half of them are gone after a certain period of time. And it's like clockwork. You repeat that time again, and half of what was left is gone, and so on. So if you start out with 100 virus particles and you have a half-life of 3 hours, which was in one of the papers on paper and cardboard, after 3 hours, you've got 50 virus particles. After 6 hours, you've got 25. After 9 hours, you've got 12 and a half. And if you do the math, you can follow it through. After 6 or 7 half-lives, it's all gone. And on top of that, we don't even know the infectious dose of COVID-19. We don't know if one virus particle would even be enough to do it. Mm-hmm. So these experiments were well-intentioned, and I'm not disputing the findings that they obtained. But what I am saying is that they were the wrong experiments. Mm-hmm. Now, with the original SARS epidemic back in 2002, 2003, 2004, there were a lot of experiments that were done addressing the same issue. And one of those experiments, one of those papers, which was the seventh reference in my comment in Lancet, was I consider to be authoritative. What those researchers did is they took smears from actual patients, SARS patients in the hospital. So we know they were starting out with infected patients. And they took these smears and smeared it on surfaces and then asked the question, is there any virus on the surface? And they found viral RNA on the surface. RNA is the genetic material of the virus. So that's good. That means they did the experiment right. They really transferred virus there. But they found no infectious virus, none. And so what that means is that the virus is gone very quickly. And that's not really surprising because of what we know about viruses. Mm-hmm. First of all, this is an enveloped virus. Enveloped viruses are the most fragile kinds of viruses. They're subject to environmental abuse. They can dry out. They die very quickly. So it would have been very surprising had these viruses survived on the surfaces for a long period of time. Mm-hmm. Second, we know a lot about how respiratory viruses are transmitted. There's a classic paper from 1987. Came out of the University of Wisconsin with rhinoviruses. Now, rhinoviruses are the most frequent cause of the common cold. 65 to 70% of the common colds are caused by rhinoviruses. And this experiment, I think it was really a fabulous experiment. They took a group of sick volunteers, sick with rhinovirus, runny noses, coughing, sneezing, the works. And they took a group of healthy volunteers, and they put them in the same room. And these, I think these were male subjects. Anyway, they had them play poker, the card game. And they took the healthy volunteers and put some kind of contraption on their necks that prevented them from touching their faces, touching their nose, mouth, or eyes. And they set them off for a number of hours, and they were playing poker with cards and chips. And then they took that group aside, and they took the cards and the chips, which were contaminated by the sick volunteers, and gave that into another room with all healthy volunteers and had them play poker as well, with no restrictions. And in fact, they were instructed to touch their faces every 15 minutes. Their noses, mouths, eyes. They were instructed to. And they played poker for a while. And then they looked at the outcome. And what did they find? The healthy volunteers that were only exposed to aerosols and could not touch their faces, they got sick. The healthy volunteers that played with the contaminated cards, the contaminated surfaces, nobody got sick.
That's amazing.
It's a very compelling experiment and a very definitive experiment. Mm-hmm. And the rhinoviruses are not even enveloped viruses. Mm-hmm. They're non-enveloped viruses. They're even sturdier.
Right.
The coronavirus. There's absolutely no reason to think that the coronavirus would behave any differently.
Right. So now we see things like, you know, the subway in New York is closed down every night for deep cleaning. I understand you got a letter from a teacher who said that her school was going to close once a week for a deep cleaning. A lot of performance for not a lot of result in your view, and the view, frankly, of the science, right?
That's right. That's right. There's very, very little in the literature that suggests that this could happen with COVID-19. Mm-hmm. There's another very compelling incident, which is reported in the scientific literature, a peer-reviewed paper. This was in South Korea. It's actually mentioned in the article in The Atlantic in which I was quoted. A mixed-use building that had businesses and residents, about 1,100 people in the building. One office in that building, it was a call center. People got sick with the COVID-19. Not everybody in that office got sick from it. The rest of the building, 947 other people in the building, 3 people got sick. That's a transmission rate of 0.3%. We don't know how those 3 people got sick. My guess is that that would have been aerosols. They got sick from aerosols. But clearly, if there was extensive surface transmission, a lot of people in that building would have gotten sick. They didn't. Yeah.
They would have sort of touched the elevator buttons together, and they would have been touching other surfaces together.
Railing on stairs, right. All kinds of, right. Now, there are 2 other reports in the literature that could be fomite transmission. Fomite is the technical term for surfaces, mm-hmm. inanimate objects. But even in these 2 other instances, there's no assurance that there wasn't an aerosol transmission. So there's really nothing definitive that you can say for sure demonstrating a fomite transmission.
Mm-hmm. And yet we're spending all this time cleaning. Do you think that's doing harm? Or is it giving us a false sense of security?
Well, sometimes it's harmful and sometimes it's not. I don't object to people wanting to feel secure. and in many instances, it's trivial. So bagging your own groceries, for example, it's trivial. But as you mentioned, the New York City subways, that's significant. It's a significant cost. It's a significant inconvenience to the people who rely on the subways at night. So there it's doing some harm. In the schools, closing the schools for a day for deep cleaning, schools don't have unlimited resources. And that's what the teacher was complaining about. That's doing some harm there. And in fact, I wrote to the school board of this teacher, and they listened to me, and they redirected their resources towards working on the ventilation systems, which is much more important than this deep cleaning. Another lady sent me an email that in her church, they were doing this deep cleaning, and the wooden on the benches of the pews was deteriorating. So they were ruining their church with this deep cleaning. She said, do we have to do this? And I wrote back and said, no, ordinary normal hygiene is all you need. Soap and water kills the virus. Ordinary alcohol kills the virus. You don't need all of these elaborate harsh chemical disinfectants. Now, I'm not saying people shouldn't be washing their hands. They should be washing their hands. But they should be doing that even without COVID-19.
Right.
Our mothers taught us, you know, you go to the bathroom, you wash your hands. You want to prepare food, you wash your hands. You touch something dirty, you wash your hands. And that's what we should be doing anyway. And that's all that's really needed. Mm-hmm. Now, you did raise a point before. Could you get it from a surface? Could you, even though there isn't a really solid case in the literature of it, yes, I think it's possible. I think if somebody who is sick contaminates the surface and within an hour, a few hours, someone else touches that surface and then touches their faces, they might get sick that way. Mm-hmm. But a lot has to happen for that to occur.
Right. And it's so really, if we're washing our hands, if we're using hand sanitizer when we don't have soap and water, that should really be enough.
More than enough.
You know, it also makes me think of, and I know this is a little outside your expertise, but it makes me think a lot about my daughter's likely going to go back to school next month. And the rule they already told us is they're going to take their temperatures on the way in. Mm-hmm. And as we know, fever is a nonspecific symptom. It could be anything, and that not every COVID patient has a fever. So in many ways, I think they're doing it to make us all feel better. Your thoughts?
Well, I think that's a pretty fair assessment, but that's very minor in the scheme of things. You know, you pass a scanner over the forehead, you know, it's no big deal.
Right.
On the other hand, those athletes going through mists of decontaminating DDT or whatever it is, or disinfectants, that might not be so good. It might not be so good for their health.
Right. So it's we got to make sure, first do no harm, right?
Right. Now, one other point I want to raise. It is a severe disease, and because of the severity, that's why we want to take precautions. So, I don't want to be cavalier about it. Mm-hmm. I think it's, in most instances, it's sufficient to just let things lie for hours or at the most one day, if you have any suspicion about it, and that the virus will be gone. Would you believe I'm getting inquiries from librarians all over the world? Because there is a project out there called Project Realm that is giving out, they say they're not giving advice, but they are. And they have experiments that have led librarians to think they have to leave materials returned to the library for a week.
I just got an email about this from my library.
Yeah. It's nonsense. So I've started a correspondence with the people running that project, and I'm waiting for a reply from them. I sent an email, I got one reply, and I've sent another one back addressing their concerns, and I'm curious to see how it plays out. But it's clearly overkill. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Goldman, thank you so much for being with me.
You're welcome.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, Stephanie Desmon, and Lamari Morales. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, Cian Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.